Thank you guys so much for coming out tonight. We're going to have some poetry reading and some dancing, and we're so excited that you're here. If you would silence your cell phones at this time, that would be great. Thank you very much. And let's enjoy the show.
Woo! All right!
Woo! Oh, t-shirts are $1, and they're in the student store. So if you'd like to buy one, you can give your money to me.
Okay.
The first song that we are going to perform is Superman.
I'm just gonna kind of leave it. Can everybody hear?
Everybody hear?
Sorry.
called The Trigger. And I didn't remember it, so I'm gonna read. I feel like just tapping the trigger. And bam! It's over. Faster than the blink of an eye. But what made me pull this trigger? You're not looking at me right. I don't like the way you're looking at me, and you'll regret it. Some that don't like you may laugh. Especially because you're not looking at me right. Don't move. Don't make me do it. Because I will. I'll do it. I'll pull this trigger. You'll see the flash and bam! It's over. I did it. I pulled the trigger. I did it, but I didn't mean to. I really didn't mean to. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to pull that trigger, but I did. What am I gonna do? There's gonna be consequences. Especially if somebody sees this. How can I fix this? How do I hide this? Oh no, I'm gonna get in trouble. I gotta get rid of this evidence. I've got to. Somebody will see what I've done. Oh man, I'm so screwed. So screwed. I gotta make this right. I wish life had a rewind button. Oh, wait. I know. I'll just press here, and I'll press here, and this one, still waiting. Deleted. Yes, all better. In life, you only get one chance, one shot. But these are the digital days, and I'm a photographer. From now on, I'll just delete unwanted frames.
Doug, with glitter. Come on up,
Doug. Let's give him a hand.
Go, baby.
I got a fall, man. Hello? I won't be his end. I'm really nervous. Just kidding. Nobody knows that I'm nervous. Okay, so this is the bridge builder. We got this a couple years ago. An old man going along highway came a evening cold and gray. So a chasm vast and deep and wide through which was flowing his sullen tide. The old man crossed in the twilight dim. That swollen stream had no fears for him. He turned one stake on the other side and built a bridge to span the tide. Old man, said a pilgrim near, you're wasting your strength building here. Your journey will end at the end of the day, and you never again must pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build this bridge at eventide? The builder lifted his old gray head. Good friend, in the path I have come, he said. There followeth after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. This swollen stream, which is not to me, to that fair-headed youth, may a pitfall be. He too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I am building this bridge for him. Yeah.
Okay, next up, Ronnie.
I read a humorous poem, this time I'm doing a dramatic poem. It's The Passionate Pilgrim by William Shakespeare. When my love swears that she is made of truth, I do believe her, though I know she lies, that she might think me some untutored youth, unskillful in the world's false forgeries. Thus vainly thinking that she thinks me young, although I know my years be past the best. I smiling credit her false speaking tongue. out facing faults, and love that love still regrets. But wherefore says my love that she is young, and wherefore say not I that I am old? Oh, love's best habit is a soothing tongue, and age in love loves not to have years told. Therefore, alive with love and love with me, since that our faults in love thus smothered me. Fair is my love, but not so fair as fickle. Mild as a dove, but neither true nor trusty. Brighter than glass, and yet as glass is brittle. Softer than wax, and yet as iron rusty. A lily pale with damask dye to grace her, none fairer nor none falser to deface her. Her lips to mine how often hath she joined, between each kiss her oaths of true love swearing. How many tales to please me hath she coined, dreading my love, the lost heir still fearing, yet in the midst of all her pure protestings, her faiths, her oaths, her tears, and all her jestings. She burned with love, as straw with fire flameth. She burned out love as soon as straw outburneth. She framed the love, and yet she fell the framing. She bade love last, and yet she fell the turning. Was this a lover or a ledger lover? Bad in the best, though excellent in neither. Good night, good rest. Neither be my share. She bade good night as she kept my rest away, and Daphne to my cabin hanged with care, to descant on the depths of my decay. Farewell, quoth she, and come again tomorrow. Farewell I could not, for I supped with sorrow. Yet, at my parting, sweetly did she smile.
Nice job, Marty. I'm going to bring this back so you have a little better light on our readers. Next up, we have Curtis Ambrose, and he's going to also be reading a Shakespeare.
I will be reading Shakespeare's sonnet 116. Sorry. Let me not to the marriage of true minds. Admit repentance, love is not love, which alters and alteration finds. Our bands which remove the world, amen. It is an ever fixed mind. It looks on campus and is never shaken. It is the star to every morning bark, whose words on them, although his height be taken. Love's not times full. The rosy lips and cheeks, within his bending supposed compass come. Love's altar is not for his great hours and weeks, but bears it out even for the evolution of them. If this be air and upon me proof, I never rip, no man ever love.
Next up, Autumn Denson. Now just, Autumn, you can come on up. Just a reminder, where is Autumn? That we are still voting for those pictures, so if you haven't put your vote in, please go ahead and do so, and we're going to be drawing in a little bit. Not drawing, but counting the votes.
Okay. So, all right, how's the
ashamed. His underwear is hanging on the lamp. His raincoat is there in the overstuffed chair, and the chair is becoming quite mucky in there. His work boot is wedged in the window, and his sweater has been thrown on the floor. His scarf and one ski are beneath the TV, and his pants and ears carelessly hung on the door. His books are all jammed in the closet. His vest has been left in the hall. His loser named Ed is asleep in his bed, and his smelly old sock has been stuck to the wall. Whoever his room this is should be ashamed. Donald or Robert or Willie or... Huh? You say it's 9? Oh dear, I do look familiar.
Okay, next up is Michaela Bethany.
Reading The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverge in Yellowwood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and long looked down, went as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other, as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and one to wear. Though, as for that, the passing there, had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden by. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet, knowing how ways lead on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this slip aside, somewhere ages and ages hence, three roads diverged in a yellow wood. And I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. Isn't it fun having Sven so far too? Okay, up next is Captain White.
Yeah, some of you probably didn't know I had a first name. So, this is a spoken word made by me. I'm sorry if you don't like it, but that's not enough. So give me a second. I literally just got off work. I'm really tired. You're ugly, you're fat, you're worthless, you're not special. These are all lies that everybody's probably heard at some point in their life. This probably made... You're ugly, you're fat, you're worthless, you're not special. These are all lies everybody has probably heard at some point in their life. This probably messes with your self-confidence, making you feel as though you're ugly, as though you're fat, as though you're not worth it. This low self-talk can become sadness and low self-esteem. Prolonged sadness will eventually become depression, and that causes a large amount of self-doubt. Although you may have found some way to fight through and past all the sadness and self-hatred, the low self-esteem never goes away. You'll often find yourself disliking one part or everything about yourself, whether it may be the little acne you may have, the way your smile looks, how your hair does that look, how like, maybe even the way that you walk. People don't see anything wrong with these things and actually think that you're perfect with the way that you are. And no matter how many times they have told you, no matter how many times they will ever tell you, you just can't believe it. It's all just some sick lie they're telling to your face just to see how you react. And then, so you shrug it off, push them away, and tell them otherwise. This may anger some of those who see you as a very special person This may anger some of those people who see you as a very special person, the way that you think so lowly about yourself, the way you only find beauty in the rest of the world surrounding yourself, it pains them. It hurts them to see such a beautiful person seeing beauty everywhere else but in themselves. I have been told a story about a person who's close to the teller had complimented them, and when they shrugged it off, they were confronted. Why do you think I would say something about your beauty if I didn't believe it? Now tell me one more time how ugly you are, how you don't find worth, specialty, beauty, talent, greatness, and amazingness to believe yourself. On that note, I will end with this quote. Train yourself to see everything beautiful in the world, and this includes making yourself. Thank you.
Okay, hello, Ashley, one more time.
Oh. It's not an enemy. Sorry, I know I should start with this one. They're both written now. I wrote them both.
Yay!
This one is more personal. Here. I was born and raised in HI, Hoy. And I lived my whole life out in Wyoming. Often people say not to come here, but I'm so proud to say I'm from here. I'm the sibling of four kids, and I'm the eldest. And I know I shouldn't tell this, but I never had the things that other kids did have, and I know I shouldn't have, but I blame mom and dad. You see, my parents never had much. I remember going to school and using tickets for a school lunch. I remember all the things I do, like watching kids at home while missing days at school. Do you know what it's like to have your mom and dad fight almost every night? If you think my life's easy for you, then put your feet in my shoes and walk a mile or two. Growing up was tough, with no school close to school. Nothing of mine was ever brand new. Everything I had, someone else outgrew, and to me, got handed down to. Remember, Mom, you dyed our light blue jeans blue so you could try to make our light blue jeans new. You'd spend your last dime if you had to, and for that, Mama, thank you. I know the months outlasted the checks, and I knew you had it rough, but I know you did your best. When push came to shove, Mom, I know you're here from stress. You gave your all and nothing less. You had it hard, Dad was hardly around. He fell in love with the streets and kept running around town. And I don't care for the things you do, Dad, but I still love you, Dad. Don't get me wrong, life wasn't always terrible, even though life seemed so unbearable. My grandparents took me in, gave a place to stay, taught me right, gave me love, still up to this day. I'll make you proud of me, and I promise you, Grandma and Granddad, I'll make you proud of me. Charence, Tiani, I give you my word, I promise you, you can always count on me. And to my brother, Gerard, you make me proud of you, and I got your back in everything you want to do. To my dad, in my eyes, you're still the man, the only dad, and the best dad that I'll ever have. And to you, Mom, thanks for everything you do. There's not enough words to express how I feel for you. I live no ordinary life. I love you all.
This next song is Robot.
Robot?
Robot? Robot.
Yeah.
Thoughts of the nation's plan. Take a chance. This could be the best thing that could ever happen to you. If not, you will learn something. Just be smart. Listen to Grandpa's words. If you have to question it, you probably shouldn't do it. Awkwardness is my specialty. What used to make me cringe, I have embraced. Yeah, I'm known for it, apparently. But it's what makes me me. Why then do I care what other people think? I should not let fear contain me in its dark box. I need to break through. I need to escape. My heart is pounding. Memories come and try to place their reality on the present. But they don't belong there. They are just there to terrorize me and make me hide back in that box. I need to get out. One chance. Give it a try. Maybe you will get burned, but think of all the good that will come from this. Look at all the good that has come through the last situation that didn't turn out so well. You got this. Just breathe. What will they think? What if I really am annoying, complicated, and a piece of work? What if everyone is just pretending? What do they think of me? What will they think of me? Shoot. Am I acting different? What if I am making this worse? Am I bringing up a storm that is not even in existence? What if all this feeling about something there that isn't even there creates a real storm? Am I making this more complicated? Am I crazy? I think I am. You are fine. Just because one person made you feel like you aren't worth anything doesn't mean other people think that. And it most certainly doesn't mean that you are worth nothing. You are worth a lot. You have a positive impact on a lot of people. But listen to that nagging voice. It lies. I can do this. Look at what good has already come of this. Just don't think of the future and all the what ifs. Shoot. What if something happens I am not ready for? What happens if I make the same mistake again? What if this whole thing blows up in my face and turns into something I dread deeply? What if I am making up this whole situation and worrying about something that is not even there? Take chance. This could be the best thing that could ever happen to you. If not, you will learn something. Just be smart. Listen to Grandpa's words. If you have to question it, you probably shouldn't do it. You got this. Just be smart. Don't fall for the lies your heart composes. Listen to your head where your logic presupposes function. Fiction.
Okay, next up, we have Emily.
Stuff. the backstory on this thing. This is actually a poem. This is like a creative writing assignment I did for college. Our professor was nuts, and he has to do this thing where, just in order to get things on a page, try to write just the longest sentence that you can. So I wrote this thing, and basically it was me in the library late at night trying to come up with a poem. And I always try to submit my poetry to this campus edition thing that published all the great poetry of the world, and then won mine, so. So basically, this is my frustration, like trying to think of like a good poem, but why doesn't it work for me? I'm sitting in this library. Okay. So on the third floor of the library sits a man who desires to construct a poem. He doesn't know what he wants to say or where he wants to go with it, so he stares at the menacing blue-lined notebook paper with its frazzled edges and stone face and feels it thump him over the head with a two-ton ink pen of aching potential. A measly page of nothing that desires to wipe out the wipe to... It's an intentional pause. Okay, stone-faced and feels it thumping over the head with a two-ton ink pen of aching potential. A measly page of nothing that desires to be wiped out with the publishable musings of a clever, dreamy, inquisitive mind. A mind like his, he thinks, which wants to write about murmuring hearts or the fall of a wave or the petunias in his grandmother's yard before she passed. But he can't bring himself to begin without stringing some underlying truth through it. A lean back and awe factor, as he's come to call it, that will make a dog-eared favorite in a brick-sized anthology 100 years from now when some gum-smacking, sleeve-rolling college freshman punk English student encounters it and is shaken with a career-altering passion for words and the intricacies of language and the power that can deliver in the appropriate situation. A passion that will set the student on the prowl to find a janky, poorly lit, congested area for a small collection of friends to crouch in the half-light of flickering flames and lap up the sweetness of classic literature in that secret. A passion so sense-ripping that this student will copy poems to memory in the margins of history lecture notes, frantically rewriting the melodic closing line of a sonnet while neglecting to record the homework due for next class. The could-be author on the third floor envisions all of this in a blink as he watches a ladybug heave itself into flight. A process, he thinks, shuffling along at an insignificant speed until finally blossoming to the envy of worms, centipedes, and crickets by spreading the half-moon wings of its shell and fizzling away in its blurry, smooth flight until it reaches its predicament as an insect stuck on the third floor of the library with a mere half-inch of double pane glass holding it in this artificial atmosphere. Flavors of musty books circulate the air and distinct saltiness of red-rimmed, procrastinating eyes as they fill with tears at the hopelessness of scribbling 5 quality pages or just 5 pages of anything at all before 8 o'clock in the morning, and that this is where the ladybug will die, crust, and meet the vacuum. Just as the motivation of the could-be writer dismantles as he realizes that a poem about a ladybug is not likely to receive any acclaim. But then he realizes, he glances around at the empty tables and neatly arranged chairs around him and wonders why he would ever write for an audience other than himself. Why the poem should be significant to any soul but the author's. Why he would voluntarily sigh away his time in creative frustration as the rest of creation went on its way making memories. And then it hits him. Memory, time, morality. The pathetic brevity of life emphasized in every history course, at every funeral, in the faces of those black and white picture relatives whose names even competent grandparents cannot recall. Those relatives who fell short of doing things worth writing or writing things worth reading and thus were confined to exist in ancestry projects and grainy photographs that could not attest to how they touched the world. Entire lives reduced to rotting masses of fertilizer and nostalgic mantelpiece pictures, leaving perhaps the greatest impact on the motivation of a desperate third-floor library dweller, shredding water with a twirling black pen, stretching out in sporadic, tentative opening lines before recoiling in anticipation of judgment, page turnability, apathetic shrugs, yawns, and years spent on an undisturbed shelf in a vast, lonely library, collecting dust and not positive attention. So he stuffs his notebook into his bulging pack, descends the stairs, positions himself firmly directly between the double doors, one hand pushing each, and walks into the cool, open, silent night air. So yeah. This is more of a, so, I'm kind of like, one of my favorite stories is the whole Lord of the Rings thing, right? The books, they made these epic movies. It's like the only few movies my dad will sit down and watch, and he's like, oh, did you see me stab that guy? He loves it. So, one of the monologues in the movie adaptation of Two Towers, the Sam guy, Frodo, they're talking about, why the heck are we even here? Like, we're not supposed to be here. We're from this tiny little place no one cares about, right? And we gotta bear this burden. So this is like one of my favorite poems. It's all in my classroom. This is Sam talking to his buddy Frodo. It's like in the great stories, Mr. Frodo, the ones that really mattered, full of darkness and danger they were. And sometimes you didn't want to know the end. Because how could the end be happy? How could the world go back to the way it was? There's so much bad that happened. But in the end, it's only a passing thing, this shadow. Even darkness must pass. A new day will come, and when the sun shines, it'll shine out the clearer. Those are the stories that stayed with you, that meant something, even if you were too small to understand why. But I think, Mr. Frodo, I do understand. I know now. Folk in those stories had lots of chances of turning back. Oh, they didn't. They kept going. Because they were holding on to something. That there's some good in this world, Mr. Frodo. And it's worth fighting for.
Mr.
Riff,
come on up.
Hey,
thank you very much. Natalie told me that when she asked me to read this, that this was her one of her favorite poems. It's called Annabelle Lee by Edgar Allan Poe. Oh. And it's about someone who is your age. And they fall in love, but the family doesn't like it. So they come up with a girl, and they take her away, and they put her in a kind of prison, which they call a sepulcher, and she dies. And for the rest of his life, he stays with her, even through her death. Annabelle Lee, by Edgar Allan Poe. It was many and many a year ago, in the kingdom by the sea, that a maiden there lived whom you may know by the name of Annabelle Lee. And this maiden she lived with no other thought than to love and be loved by me. She was a child and I was a child, in this kingdom by the sea. But we loved with a love that was more than love, I and my Annabelle Lee. With a love that the winged seraphs of heaven coveted her and me. And this was the reason that, long ago, in this kingdom by the sea, a wind blew out of a cloud by night, chilling my Annabelle Lee, so that her high-born kinsmen came and bore her away from me, and shut her up in a sepulcher in this kingdom by the sea. The angels, not half so happy in heaven, when envying her and me. Yes, that was the reason, as all men know in this kingdom by the sea, that the wind came out of a cloud, chilling and killing my Annabelle Lee. But our love, it was stronger by far than the love of those who are older than we, of many far wiser than we. And neither the angels in heaven above, nor the demons down under the sea, can ever dissever my soul from the soul of the beautiful Annabelle Lee. For the moon never beams without bringing me dreams of the beautiful Annabelle Lee. and the stars never rise, but I see the bright eyes of the beautiful Annabelle Lee. And so, all the night tide, I lie down by the side of my darling, my life and my bride, in her sepulcher there by the sea, in her tomb by the side of the sea. And before I go, can we give a big round of applause? Woo!
Okay, so next up we have John Riddle Jr. Like we're reading some Shakespeare. Oh, I'm sorry, John Riddle III.
That's right.
I stand corrected. All right,
go on up. Oh, no.
John Riddle! John Riddle!
Banana Man.
That's right.
Mr. Chiquita. Oh no.
Well, say, this poem has nothing to do with bananas. It's just...
Can you do the splits?
No, but I'm sure this poem's going to be very appealing.
Bye.
Actually, can I have everybody that did the art competition stand up so we can see you? Anybody that participated in the art competition? Participating. It's so important to get out there and get some of your art out there. I really, really appreciate it. So, okay, so our second prize goes to number 7, which was Derek Holmberg. So Derek, I'm here. Derek Holmberg. Okay, must be present to win. So, I will go ahead and read the first prize, and then we will have a second prize person. Second prize goes to number 5, which is Michaela Ward. Michaela, are you here? Okay, let's see if she's in the student store. Okay, I'll read first prize now. First prize goes to number 8, which was Gabrielle Chase. Good job, Gabrielle Chase. I don't actually have the prize in my hand right now, so we'll go again afterwards, or I'll put it in your box. Okay. So anyway, thank you so much for participating. Good job, that was beautiful. For those of you that didn't see, I think that yours was the one with the face that went into the Northern Lights, yeah. Right? Do you want to tell us anything about it? She doesn't want to say anything. But you can go look at it, and that's okay. All right, so thank you very much. Good job. Okay. Okay, so one more time. We have Derek Holmberg here. Nope, okay. What about Michaela Ward? No? Okay. Alright, then we're going to move down to number 11, Kathleen Wild.
Oh.
So the second prize goes to Kathleen Wild. So when you participate, make sure that you come to the event so that you can get money and all of that stuff. So thank you guys so much for coming tonight. We really, really appreciate it. And don't forget that we have t-shirts for sale out there. There are t-shirts from previous years. We will have music t-shirts coming out a little bit later this year. But we just have our older t-shirts right now, and they're only $1. So if you want to get a t-shirt, it's $1. And don't forget that at 7 o'clock on Sunday night, we have our final show, which is the open mic on Sunday at 7 o'clock. And we're going to have some really good performers for you. So thank you again so much for coming. Please feel free to hang out for a little bit, and have a great night.